Good evening. I'd like to welcome you to the Sunday night service for Bay Springs Baptist Church on January 17th, 2021. We're so glad that you've joined us. We want to welcome you to our service, and I do want to mention a few things by way of announcement. First of all, January 31st, we will have the Lord's Supper in our morning worship service, and we're excited about that. Hope that you can join us in person. If you're unable to join us in person and you'd like to drop by the week of and pick up the elements, and you can take those home, and when we do the Lord's Supper, you can join us in doing that. So if you would like to come by the church office the week leading up to January 31st, you can pick that stuff up, and we'll look forward to a great day of worship. Also, if you are interested in participating in a Zoom Sunday school class or discipleship training class, we'd love to hear back from you. We're kind of trying to gauge interest on whether or not folks would like to be involved in either of these two ways. And so if you don't mind, to call the church office or call Brother Doug's cell number and let us hear back from you. We'd love to have some of your feedback. Thank you so much for joining us, and let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you for the privilege that we've been given to worship. And God, we're so grateful for our church family. God, we're grateful for the community that we live in. Father, we do realize that many are sick and many are hurting. And Lord, we pray for them. We pray for healing. And Lord, we pray for comfort. God, bless our worship tonight. Anoint it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good evening. Thanks so much for joining us. We certainly live in uncertain times, but we are not alone. God is with us because Jesus Christ is alive, and He takes care of us. He looks after us. He provides us wisdom and guidance every single day, every moment of every day, if we'll simply listen to Him. And so we're going to sing Because He Lives, and it just reminds us that He is there for us. So let's sing together Because He Lives.
God sent His Son, they called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my I can face tomorrow
because he lives. And then one day, and then one day, I'll cross the river. I'll fight life's fight. No war with pain. And then as death gives way, and then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the light of glory, and I'll know he reigns because he lives, because he lives. I can face tomorrow because he lives. All fear is gone because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
Amen. Our next song that we're going to sing is, "Oh, How He Loves You and Me." And he certainly does, and he proved that when he went to the cross and died for us. Endure that agonizing death because of his great love for us and his desire to give us a way for salvation. Let's sing, "Oh, How He Loves You and Me."
Jesus to Calvary did go, his love for sinners to show, his love for sinners to show. What he did there, what he did there, brought hope from despair. Oh, how
thank you so much. Miss Miranda's going to come and bring our special music for tonight. I sure appreciate her doing that.
Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares. to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. You have no against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the
Amen. Thank you, Miss Miranda. Thank you for joining us tonight. If you have your copy of God's Word, I want to invite you to join me in the Gospel of Mark. I'm going to begin reading in Mark chapter 2, and this evening we're thinking about bringing people to Jesus. Mark chapter 2, And I want us to read beginning in verse 1. The Bible says, "And again he entered Capernaum after some days, and it was heard that he was in the house. Immediately many gathered together so that there was no longer room to receive them, not even near the door. And he preached the word to them. Then they came to him, bringing a paralytic who was carried by four men. And when they could not come near him because of the crowd, they uncovered the roof where he was. So when they had broken through, they let down the bed on which the paralytic was lying. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, 'Son, your sins are forgiven you.' And some of the scribes were sitting there and reasoning in their hearts, 'Why does this man speak blasphemies like this? Who can forgive sins but God alone?' But immediately when Jesus perceived in his spirit that they reasoned thus within themselves, he said to them, 'Why do you reason about these things in your hearts? Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, "Your sins are forgiven you," or to say, "Arise, take up your bed and walk"? But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, "I say to you, arise, take up your bed, and go to your house." Immediately he arose, took up the bed, and went out in the presence of them all, so that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, We've never seen anything like this." You know, this is a great little story found in Mark chapter 2. And tonight I want you to think with me about bringing people to Jesus. Now, as we begin tonight, I want you to put on your thinking caps for just a moment, and I'm going to make a statement, and I want you to think about how this applies to you personally. You and I, we are either compelling people to come to Jesus, or we are repelling them by our actions. So let me give you a moment to just consider what I'm saying. We're either compelling people, we're either encouraging them to come to Jesus, or we're pushing them away from Jesus. Now, as Christians, we have a responsibility to lift Jesus up and to make the gospel attractive. When you look at the call of disciples in the New Testament, the first call that a disciple received was to follow Jesus. Jesus said to James and John, "Come and follow me." That was the first call of discipleship. But the second call of a disciple was then to go and to fish for men. So we've been saved for a purpose. We were created in Christ Jesus. Ephesians 2 tells us this. We were created in Christ Jesus to do good works. And part of those good works that we're to be doing as Christians is the responsibility to urgently labor to bring people to our Savior. So with this thought in mind, I want you to think about this poem. To lose one's wealth is sad indeed. To lose one's health is more. But to lose one's soul is such a loss that no one can restore. And so tonight, just a real simple and short message about you bringing people to Jesus. There are a couple things I want you to see. Number one, I want you to see a disruption. Now, beginning in verses 1 through 4, you're going to see the account of the story. Jesus is, the Bible says that he's entered Capernaum and that he's preaching in a house. And evidently, the crowds are growing that are following Jesus, so much so that there's no more room in that house, not even near the door. Okay, so Jesus is preaching. You know, when you study the Gospels over and over, you'll see that Jesus was accustomed to disruptions and to distractions. And many times when he was disrupted, you would see some of the greatest personal touches of his ministry. So Jesus is preaching in the house, and four men, brought their friend to Jesus. And they did that by coming through the roof. Now, if you've got your Bibles, look at verse 2. Immediately many gathered together. There was no longer room. There was a crowd of folks there, not even near the door. And it says he preached the word to them. We'll come back to that. Then they came to him bringing a paralytic who was carried by four men, and they could not come near him because of the crowd, so they uncovered the roof. Now, if you've ever spoken publicly, folks, there are some things that when you get distracted, you just can't overcome. Can you imagine me trying to preach a sermon and somebody coming through the roof? Let me assure you, we would all take note of that, okay? That would get our attention. There are a couple things under this disruption I want you to notice. First of all, we've kind of touched on it already, the masses of people. So Jesus' popularity is growing quickly. Crowds are drawn to hear him, and there was a sense of a magnetism that he had. Ladies and gentlemen, he still has that. That was true then. It's also true now. Also, think about the message that he preached. The Bible says in verse 2, the very last part of verse 2, that he preached the word to these people. So get this now. Just think about this. Jesus was the word, and he preached the word. You have the God-man telling the God story to men. Ladies and gentlemen, just a reminder, just a refresher, we ought always to teach and preach God's word. And then the masses, the message, and the main. So the man in this story, I want you to know that he was very fortunate that he had four great friends. You say, what do you mean by it? How do you know they were great? The fact that they brought this man to Jesus, that they were willing to do whatever it took to get their friend to Jesus, he was fortunate. That help that he received was only found in Jesus. Ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you, in 2021, in the midst of the COVID pandemic, people need Jesus. Don't forget that people need Jesus. I realize that there's a lot of concern about health and wellness, and there should be. But ladies and gentlemen, don't you forget why we're here. Because people need Jesus. So we see number one, a disruption. We see number two, a determination. Now let's talk about these friends. And let me say this to you. It is never easy to get people that we care about to Jesus. If you're going to try to bring somebody to Jesus, let me assure you, there will be an obstacle, there will be a challenge, there will be a distraction, and there will be reasons to give up. But these men were determined to get their friend to Jesus. When you look at this story, there are several things about their determination. You see their concern. They genuinely cared about their friend. They were acquainted with his situation, and they knew that if they didn't intervene and get involved, if they didn't help, their friend would have never been able to get to Jesus. Let me just ask you, is there concern in your heart about people and their need for Jesus? I'm going to let you answer that question. I want you to notice also their creativity. Now, it was more than pity that prompted these men. I believed it was sacrificial love. It would have been much easier for them to give up, but they made a plan and they acted on that plan. Ladies and gentlemen, our mission is to get people to Jesus any way that we can. Now, I want you to think about this. Every program in the church ought to serve as a stretcher to get people to Jesus. I want you to let that sink in just a minute. Everything that we do, ladies and gentlemen, if we preach, the purpose of preaching ought to be to get people to Jesus. If we sing, the purpose of singing ought to be to get people to Jesus. If we have Sunday school, if we have discipleship training, if we have visitation, if we have deacons meeting, if we have any meeting, the purpose ought to be to get people to Jesus. I don't know about you, but I think sometimes we've forgotten about our purpose. So there was concern, there was creativity, and there was certainty. You say, what do you mean by certainty? These men were confident that if they could get their friend to Jesus, that Jesus could make all the difference in the world for their friend. And hey, ladies and gentlemen, they were right. because Jesus can make all the difference in the world. So you got number one, a disruption. Number two, a determination. And then three, a demonstration. Now, what happens in the story? Well, you kind of know what happens. When Jesus saw their faith, this is verse 5, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven you." So there's going to be some going back and forth, because you got religious leaders and they're listening to what Jesus said and their ears perk up. But man, I don't want you to miss this. Don't worry about all the legalism involved here. I want you to listen. Listen to what Jesus said in verse 10. "But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, 'I say to you, take up your bed and go to your house.'" And the Bible says in verse 12, "Immediately he arose," talking about the paralytic, took up the bed and went out from the presence of them all, so that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, "We never saw anything like this." So these four determined friends and their paralytic friend, they received much more from Jesus than they had hoped for. That's the way it is with him. In fact, Ephesians 3:20 says, "Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think." Man, when you come to Jesus, you get way more than what you thought you were going to get. Notice what the crippled man received. Number one, he received God's forgiveness. Now, it's interesting to me that before Jesus said, "Take up your bed and walk," it's interesting that he said, "Son, your sins are forgiven you." You know what he's doing? Jesus is teaching us the importance of the spiritual over the physical. It was more important that this man went home right with God than it was that this man was able to get back on his feet. Now Jesus granted both, okay? This man experienced God's forgiveness and he was able to walk out of that place. So God's forgiveness, but also God's favor. And the man, now get this, he would have never been able to get to Jesus without his friends, but that same man was able to walk home by himself, fully justified. Now, I don't know about you, but ladies and gentlemen, it doesn't get any better than that. That is a great message for us. So let me ask you, are you bringing people to Jesus? You say, "Preacher, hey, I'm just lucky if I can get to church myself." Are you bringing people to Jesus? Don't forget, in all the stuff that's going on in the world today, in all the political upheaval, in all of the physical illness, don't forget why we're here. People still need Jesus. Bring them to Jesus. Pray with me. Father, thank you for your word. God, thank you for its clarity. God, thank you for the example of these four friends who brought their ailing brother to Jesus. God, help us commit ourselves to do the same. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I don't know how this message found you tonight, but if you need to make a decision, if you need to talk with someone, please contact me. I'd love to hear back from you. Thank you for joining us.